this whole home field advantage situation with the Bucs. So obviously we all know it's here in town and they do have home field advantage kind of, but then again, they also don't. So Right. Can you kind of explain that to us and whether they actually will have any sort of advantage in this game tomorrow?
Well, in a conventional year, the home field advantage may be pretty profound for the Bucs, who, as we all know, are the first team in Super Bowl history to be playing the game in their home stadium. Normally, the Chiefs would have arrived Monday night, so they would have had to get acclimated to a hotel and practicing at a facility not their own, and then you would have all the potential pitfalls of Super Bowl week, such as the parties and the nightclubs and all the trappings that are appealing to young 20 and mid-20-year-old guys. But they have none of that this year. The Chiefs are not arriving until later this afternoon. So just like the Bucs, they've been able to sleep in their own beds all week. They've been able to train in their own facility all week. This is just a basic road trip for them. They're going to arrive this afternoon around 4 o'clock at Tampa International Airport, I believe. They'll play the game, and right after the game, they'll fly back to Kansas City. It's a basic business trip for them. So as far as that goes, the Chiefs, you know, have had kind of the same benefits as the Bucs. And you get to game day, it's not going to be a 70,000 person audience, which you would presume would be predominantly Bucs in a conventional year. We all know that the capacity is going to be capped at fewer than 25,000, I believe, and 7,500 of those are vaccinated healthcare workers, which is a great gesture by the NFL to let those people in for free to see the game after all they've done for us during this pandemic. So you're going to have a limited crowd. So again, you know, just the crowd noise factor is going to be kind of neutralized for both teams. So it's a home field advantage for the Bucs. Obviously, they're playing in a stadium they know better than anyone. They could literally walk to work if they had to, but by the same token, it's not as profound as it would be in a conventional year. So the home field advantage is kind of neutralized.
Gotcha. Well, I have to imagine if they got to pick whatever stadium they wanted to play in, they'd probably pick their own. So,
right.
You know, I mean, they got that. They have that going for them.
Yeah. You know, they know that field and the nuances and the nooks of Raymond James Stadium better than anybody. So that's a definite distinct advantage. And you think about this too, Rachel, Super Bowl week, and a couple of CBS sports analysts brought this up, including Boomer Esiason, who's played in a Super Bowl, and Charles Davis, who has been calling college and pro games forever. In Super Bowl week, everybody that you know, that you've known in your lifetime, from your mom and dad to your eighth cousin twice removed, is hitting you up for tickets. Well, there aren't that many tickets this year, so each player has a very limited number. So you don't have the distraction of everybody and their brother, you know, asking you for tickets. And that can be a big headache during game week. That can be a huge distraction in itself. That distraction is gone. So again, both teams kind of have it even in terms of just game week advantage. It's kind of neutralized, but you're right. You know, if the Bucs have their choice of stadium, they got it. They're playing in their home stadium, one they know better than anybody.
Exactly. So they've got that going for them. But on the flip side of things, they do have a couple guys hurt. So that's something that's not exactly going their way. Cam Bray added to the injury report yesterday. So where do they stand with all the injuries that they have right now?
Actually, the news is pretty good as of today, Saturday afternoon. From what I've heard, various reports, officially Cameron Bray, the tight end, who's had a great postseason. He's got 11 postseason catches and a touchdown. He has a back strain, but from things we've heard on the national level, it may not be as bad as feared. And I think if they were to play the game today, he would try to go. Antonio Brown, the receiver who missed the NFC Championship game with a knee injury, he was a full participant at Friday's practice. It looks like he's going to play. He's listed as questionable, but it looks like he's going to play. And the big concern, the two starting safeties, Jordan Whitehead and Antoine Winfield Jr., Jordan has a shoulder injury. Antoine has an ankle injury. They were full participants at Friday's practice, and they have no status on the injury report. Like a status, you're either listed as doubtful or questionable or probable. They don't even have a status listed, which means they're going to play. So as of right now, the injury report's looking pretty good for the Bucs.
Okay, well, that's great news then.
Yeah, absolutely.
So something else I wanted to talk about that you had written about earlier this week. Something that I find very interesting about this team is their offensive line. It's not guys from Alabama and LSU that you're always seeing in the college game. It's guys who didn't even play Division I football.
Right.
And people didn't expect them to end up in this position and to be playing in a Super Bowl. So just how impressive has their performances been throughout the year, and how rare is it to see something like that in the game right now?
It's a great testament to not only the scouting department of the Buccaneers being able to find these guys as obscure places. It just reinforces the notion that if you're good enough, they will find you. That talent can be found at all levels of college. And the Bucs have proven that with their three starting interior linemen. Ryan Jensen, the center, went to Colorado State Pueblo, which is a Division II program. Alex Kappa, the right guard, who's hurt, who's not going to play in this game. He went to Humboldt State. And off the top of my head, Rachel, I'm not even sure what state that's in, but that's a Division II program. The guy who replaced him at right guard, Aaron Stinney, went to James Madison, Division I AA. And of course, Ali Marpet, the anchor at left guard, went to Hobart College in central upstate New York, which is a Division III program. Let me ask you this, Rachel, where did you go to high school?
Sarasota, Florida.
Okay. The home attendance at a Sarasota high school game is probably greater than what Ali Marpet played at Hobart College. They averaged about 800 or 900 people a game. So again, it's just a testament to the Bucs being able to uncover these guys, just being able really just to look through every crack and crevice of the college football landscape and find these guys. And it's not just the fact that they're playing at the NFL level, they're playing very well. Tom Brady is a pocket passer. So if you're going to pressure him, the best way is to come up the middle. You know, he can step up in the pocket, and he's still mobile enough at 43 to elude outside pressure. But if that pressure comes up in the middle, he's in trouble. And those guys are all the middle interior blockers. And they've been outstanding for Tom Brady this year. I went back and checked, and I think over the last 10 games, he's been sacked more than once in only two of those 10 games. And Tom has gone out of his way just to praise the protection he's got up front throughout the course of the season. And the three main guys providing that interior protection are from schools that the average person has never heard of. It's kind of amazing and cool.
Yeah, it really is amazing. And it's good that Brady does give him a little shout out.
Yeah.
Excuse me, here and there. They deserve all of that. They let Brady be Brady, so.
Right.
So switching gears a little bit, going back to the last time this team was in the Super Bowl, and obviously they did win, you kind of did a little look back on where those guys have all ended up. So of all the guys that you found out what they're doing right now, like what are some of the more interesting things that these guys are up to?
Oh, that's an easy one. The most interesting was Darian Barnes, a reserve on the 2002 Super Bowl team. I found out he was a contestant on the final season of The Worst Cooks in America on the Food Network. And I didn't ask him if he got the, you know, inimitable title of Worst Cook in America, but he appeared on that show. So I thought that was really cool. You had Tim Wansley, who's got a food truck service in Decatur, Georgia, and, you know, coaching on the side. You've got a couple of coaches who are in this area coaching high school football. Mike Allstott, Northside Christian in St. Petersburg. Ryan Benjamin's been the head coach at River Ridge High in Newport Richey for a number of years. Dan Goodspeed, who was a backup on that team, on that Bucs team, helps Ryan Benjamin. So I thought that was kind of cool that you've got a number of guys kind of giving back to their community and coaching at the grassroots level. But I don't think anything can top Darian Barnes, you know, a contestant on The Worst Cooks in America. That was probably the most labor-intensive story I did all week, Rachel. It was really tough tracking down all those guys. I tried to track down every member of the 53-man Super Bowl roster and all the primary coaches, and I found all except eight. There are eight that are still out there that to this day I'm trying to find so I can update the story on TampaBay.com, but they are mighty tough to uncover. But yeah, it was a lot of fun going back in time and finding out what those guys are doing.
This is the kind of investigative work that you don't just find
everywhere. That's exactly right. That's exactly right.
The worst cooks in America, though, that definitely does take the cake.
Yeah, you can't top that.
I should go on that show, personally. I burnt a grilled cheese the other day, so that tells me anything.
I think you'd be a candidate.
Anyways, so just kind of wrap this up here. Can you kind of give us a preview into tomorrow, and what do you think some of the keys are going to be in the game?
I think a big key is those interior guys protecting Tom Brady. I think a big key will be how the Chiefs' offensive line protects Patrick Mahomes. Now, we all know Patrick Mahomes is a little more mobile than his counterpart on the other side. He can do a lot of things and do a lot of danger outside the pocket. But you've got some edge rushers in Shaquille Barrett and Jason Pierre-Paul to where if the Bucs can get a push up the middle and kind of force Patrick Mahomes outside, the Bucs have the speed and the athleticism to create problems, even for Patrick Mahomes when he gets out of the pocket. So I think that's an interesting matchup. I'm a big believer, Rachel, in the intangible of momentum. I've said this a number of times this week on various radio segments, and the Bucs are clicking. They are playing with incredible momentum. They've won 3 consecutive playoff games on the road. They have won, what is it now, 7 in a row? I've lost count. I believe they won 7 games in a row. I just believe that momentum is a tangible thing. It's an intangible, but I believe it's a tangible thing going into this game. I believe Tom Brady trusts all his weapons, from Antonio Brown and Mike Evans down to Tyler Johnson and Scotty Miller. He trusts them to be able to go to them in any situation, which he has proven in the playoffs. And of course, these guys trust Tom because he's been there a million times in this situation. So that mutual trust is a big key and a reason I think they have a lot of momentum and are clicking right now. And I just think the Bucs are going to continue clicking. I like them winning this game.
Yeah, we'll see if they can get it done. I think we'll see something much closer to the second half of the last Bucs-Chiefs game than the first.
I agree.
So, and Bucs fans are hoping that's the case too.
Yes.
So Joey, thanks for taking a few minutes to chat with us here today. Everyone, make sure you're following along with him on social media, keeping up with his stories on TampaBay.com, all throughout. I mean, we're now at the end of the season, but into the offseason, next season, so on and so forth, and especially tomorrow, during the big game.